Jennifer lose her rat, all of a sudden they can't get in. She said, wait, hold on, we not take that. Jenny go right, run, go buy some pies up a master, cause tonight me have to kill the big cat. And she go for kill the cat, I don't want near it that. She said, morning, Miss Mary, what a nice red frock. You look so nice, and you look so hot. Thou shalt not kill the commandment that so we're not about to do it, cause we know God to watch. Okay, so that's just the initiating activity. We're going to move on to the meat of the matter now. So we all know that we must write a story in 45 minutes. That sounds like it's not achievable, though. 45 minutes story, 400 to 450 words, wow. But it can be done because persons have done it, and you can also do it. And so I'm going to give you the strategy as to how you will do it so that you can actually get the 25 marks for this section. So let's get into it. What I'm going to be doing first, though, I'm going to read a sample story, and then we're going to be, I'm going to model the sample story, and then we're going to identify the elements from the sample story. And so that when you're writing your own stories, you can also, you know, you can practice while you're at home now. Write stories, identify the elements, so that when it's time for CSEC, you'd be effective story writers, right? Baby, stop bothering. Okay, let's get to it. Now the phone. Not no. Give me a minute. Oh Lord. Right. Hold on. Where do I find the thing?
Go in a PowerPoint on my phone.
Oh yeah, download PowerPoint, goodie. Oh, good, we're ready. Sorry, people, sorry. All right, we're ready. So CSEC, in the story writing section, what is story? Oh, good. In CSEC, right, for the story writing section, you'll be getting two questions, right? You'll get a picture to write a story from, or you will get a stimulus. The stimulus might either be you getting a line to include in your story, or you getting a title of a story and for you to write that story based on that title. The choice is yours. You must, in fact, though, include or write your story based on one of the three things or the two things given. So it says you are given 45 minutes. You must answer one question from this section. Your answer should be approximately 400 to 450 words in length. And of course, you must write in standard English. However, dialect may be used in conversation. You will be assessed for the stimulus that you use, how you develop and organize the content of your writing, how you use language appropriate to your audience, purpose, and content, and how you use appropriate grammar, sentence structure, paragraph, vocabulary, spelling. Good. So once you employ all these things as much as possible, because you will not be able to do all, but once you're able to do as much as possible, then you should be able to get 20 out of that 25. So let's move on to the sample story now. So this is a stimulus. Once I entered the galvanized door, I saw a pair of legs higher than my head. Write a story which include these words, 25 marks. Good. So we're ready to write our story. So I'm going to be reading the story now. As I stood there, my very soul cried out. She hung there like a black apostrophe to pain. Hold on. Wait, just give me a minute, please. All right, ready again. Sorry, baby chronicles. Oh, hold on. Yes, no matter. Okay, oh Lord, ready now. All right, so let's get back now. As I stood there, my very soul cried out. She hung there like a black apostrophe to pain. Emotions didn't fail to elude my already sundered eyes. At that very moment, it seemed that all I knew was pain, black biting pain. She was gone, my only hope. Now I was all alone and I had to face the unimaginable, painful reality. It all started that day when we left the little shack we had called home for 16 years. My sister, my motivation, my strength was the only face I can recall. Where we came from, I can't remember. What I can remember, however, was a bitterness I felt when I looked at the other little boys. They had it all. They had it all. A mother, father, money, shoes, and looks. And this, and all this did was break my already crushed heart. What am I living for? I often ask, sometimes aloud. In Sunday school, I remember them talking about this God. They claim he is the most supreme, the most peaceful, the most powerful. What they failed to say was how this God watched me hurt, how this God let my sister be the victim of unspeakable horrors. God. My father, the only parent I knew, stood there and watched as he raped her. Of course he didn't mind. He was being paid on my sister's pain. Little scrawny me stretched my hand out to remind her that there is a God. As I touched her, she shivered. She was cold. Tears danced down her long, thin face with every painful moan. I was helpless. There was nothing I could have done. At every grasp for here, my father laughed at her, his own flesh and blood. God, I screamed, help her, please. But the 6 years I had earned on this wretched her didn't give me the bravery to utter those words out loud. I am heartbroken before I know love. I am sad before I know happiness. I am robbed before I had anything or I stole. He left her there sprawled like a slaughtered animal as he threw papers at my father as payment. And with an arc back, he zit our shack, our home. Mary, I'm sorry, I muttered. She smiled the most peaceful, untouched, heavenly smile there ever could be. Maybe she's God, I thought. How then can she smile after such a... If the okay, she interrupted my thought. God will hear her prayers one day, she continued. Oh, well, at least I know she wasn't God. But it was hard for me to understand then what that smile really meant. Johnny, please go outside and bring my dress, she bidden pitifully. As I got up, I looked to the sun. It was shining so brightly outside, but it was like the sun rays never seemed to enter her house. Home, rather. Through the four holes in the wall, we call windows, the sun rays stood still. They weren't rays of hope, but merely citizens governed by the laws of physics. I walk to the line where my sister's cloth she called dress hung. Just then I saw that beast, that thing that called himself a man, drunk coming up the road, drunk on money paid for the pain of my innocent sister. I saw the fierce anger in his dark evil eyes as he was coming closer. I grabbed the dress and ran to my sister. Once I entered the galvanized door, I saw a pair of legs higher than my head. She hung there in the hair with foam oozing from her mouth. Mary! Mary! I cried as I saw that smile on her face again, quite briefly this time. I kneeled to the ground and looked at what I guess was my sister's last words, carved to the floor. Run, Johnny, run. I knew that was my name she taught me, but I didn't know what the other two words were. But I felt the urge to get up and walk. Where the energy-deprived strength came from, I didn't know. I walked quickly as I could have, and at the middle of the paved road, all I could remember was, beep, beep, beep. Glam. That's the end of the stamper story. So we're going to, while we are about to get into the story itself, or the information regarding story, I want somebody to tell me or define a short story for me, please. So we're going to be waiting on a minute for somebody to do that. Darian, please define what a short story is for me, please. Yes, Darian, in time now. 1 minute. Why are you bawling? What is a short story? While we're getting at it, let me tell you. So, a short story. Sorry, my baby. You can't go and sleep. Come on, baby. All right, so we're ready. Let me just go. A short story. Really? Yes. Give me a minute again. Okay. Yeah. On your bed. All right. So, it says a short story is a piece of fiction that can be read in one sitting. It focuses on a self-contained incident or a series of link incidents. The aim of a short story is that it must evoke a single effect or mood. So what this is saying is the short story must focus on one incident. Or if it is that you're great and you want to have your story focusing on more than one incident, the incidents must be related. They must be linked, right? And the whole purpose of story writing is for entertainment. So remember, it's fictitious, even though it can be non-fiction. But most, if not all, stories are fictitious. And so the main purpose of writing a story is for entertainment. So in a story, however, people, you will have a character. The character will be at a location in the story, right? The character will have a problem in the story. And this character will try to resolve the conflict, or the problem rather. He or she might fail at resolving the conflict, or he might succeed. So not because not all stories necessarily have to, the resolution have to be in the story. It could be that the character is not able to resolve the incident in the story. So just before I move on, we say what a story is. And in the story, it must have a character. The character must be at a location. He must have a problem and he's trying to resolve this problem. It could be resolved, or he might fail at resolving it. Let's move on. So what are the elements of a story? We are asked to write a story, but in order for us to write effective and good stories, we must know what to include in the story. And so we're going to be moving on to elements of story writing. Do anybody on the live know what are some of the elements that must be employed in writing stories or short stories, that is? Anybody? No? All right. So, the elements of a short story, right? We must have a plot. We must have characters. We must have setting. We must have theme. We must have point of view, and we must have title. The story must have a title. And so these are the elements, just going through them again. It must have a plot. It must have characters, setting, theme, point of view, and title. So what we're going to be doing next is that we're going to be using the sample story read, and we're going to be see if we're able to identify some of these elements in that short story. Because remember, the whole purpose of you writing a short story in CSEC is so that you can be graded. So you have to, in fact, be able to utilize or employ or include some of these elements in your story so that when the examiner is looking for elements, they are able to say, oh, yeah, man, this is 5 elements. Oh, yes. I'm able to identify 4 elements, yes. And elements can't, not because you are told that you must include elements. Let me say, just I throw them in there, you know. Because what we sometimes do is that we are told that a story, we need to have certain plot, characters, theme, point of view, title. So because I'm told that all I do is just fling in certain, fling, they must be included appropriately and it must make sense. Good? So we're going to be moving on now and looking at the sample story and see if we're able to identify the elements posited here. So, setting. It says setting is a time and place when and where the main events of the story takes place. So this is self-explanatory. It means you must include where the story will take place, when it will take place. Good? So we must be able to identify that. So it says it must give the reader that picture. So in my story, or the story that was read earlier, we're going to read the setting of that story. It says, as I got up, I looked to the sun. It was shining so brightly outside, but it was like the sun rays never seemed to enter our house. Through the four holes in the wall, we call windows, the sun rays stood still. They weren't rays of hope, but merely citizens governed by the law of physics. So, right away from reading this first line or these sentences, we're able to identify where the story will take place. Can somebody tell me where the story is taking place? And when? We know when because it says the sun is shining, so we can assume that it could be midday. Can be in the night because sun is shining in the night, right? It also says, it tells us where the story is taking place as well. It says, as I got up, I looked to the sun, it was shining so bright outside. It says our home, which means the story is taking place in the vicinity of the smutty yard. Oh, good. It says in the setting, you must use descriptive techniques. These may include metaphors, similes, onomatopoeia. What this means is, people with the setting, you cannot tell me what is happening, but you must show me. I need to envision what is happening. You know, you tell me nothing. Cause I am not. I want to be involved in the story as a reader. And for me to be involved in the story, I must be able to visualize or imagine. So you must bring me into your world through your story. And in order for you to bring me into your world through your story, I should be able to see what is happening. So, in order for you to show me what's happening instead of telling me, you must incorporate literary devices. Come on. The words scammed us. It was Sunday, 12 o'clock. Me not vision that, envision that. That's lame. So how about, though, I know it's night. What are the features? What are the things that I can show readers that it's night instead of me using the word night? Come on, there are more than one things. You know what happened at night. The sun, we're not seeing a moon in the night. So how about I describe outside so that I can show the reader that the action is in fact happening in the night. Or the action is happening in the day. If you notice what this writer did, the writer didn't say it was day, it was daylight. No, the writer incorporated things that would connote that this action is happening in the day. So that's what we're saying. Use descriptive language. So use similes, use metaphors so that your words will have the reader imagining what is happening instead of you telling them. We're going to be moving on to the next element, which is characterization or characters. Of course, in every movie we watch, when this setting is created, so say for instance, it's a horror movie, they create this setting, so they have the sound effect. They have the haunted house, the house dark. That's the setting. But the story can't be a story without characters, can it? And so characters are vital to a story. It says characters are the things or people that are a part of the story. So in your story, however, you must have a main character and minor characters. You can limit your characters to three because you only have 45 minutes. People don't play heroes. All of them when we know dead. Hero and heroine dead, which means we're not playing on. Good? And so because of such, we're going to limit our stories to three characters. When we do that, we would be able to develop our characters properly. So you must have a main character, and this character is called the protagonist. So the story will surround this character. Could be person or persons. I'm limiting the protagonist to one, because we don't want to make life complicated. So in this story, the sample story that I was with earlier, the protagonist in the story, just give me a minute. I have to be running down this little boy. Jesus. Crying. Right. So in the story I read earlier, right, the protagonist was, it says, God, I scream, help her, please. But the 6 years I had earned on this wretched hurt didn't give me the bravery to utter those words out loud. So right away, we know that the narrator is the protagonist. The story is centered around him. So he's narrating the story and he's also a character in the story. Come, baby. Jesus. Come. In a minute again. Mm-mm. Baby. So. Okay. Oh Lord. All right, so as I said before, in your story, you must have a protagonist, which is this person the story will be centered on, right? Then along with the protagonist, you will have supporting characters. What is wrong with baby? Go on. Good. So you will have supporting characters as well. And so these supporting characters, they play a minor role, but they are essential in the development of the story. Come on. The story can't only have one character. That makes sense. And so even though the supporting characters don't play a major role, they are needed, necessary for the development of the story. And so we must have one or two minor characters who will help the major character to evolve the plot. So it says, my father, the only parent I knew, stood there and watched as he raped her. Of course, he didn't mind. He was being paid on my sister's fame. So in this story, we realize that the sister is a minor character and the father is also one. And so next point is you must, in fact, allow your character to talk, people. Your character must talk. In order for me to decide or differentiate between the characters in the story, I will employ dialogue in my story so that I will know what the protagonist is saying and what the minor character is saying. So allow the character to talk. It is through the dialogue that persons will know what personality trait the character has, whether minor or major. And so we're moving on to the other element, which is plot. You can't go in. Go on, you know? Jesus. Come in. Then all right, plot. Sorry about that, people. Oh, Lord. I have an 18-month-year-old Pitney. So next one is plot. Plot says, this is a sequence of events in a story, right? So that's what plot is. So this means then that for the plot, you cannot write the plot. People tend to go in the examination with a story already in mind. So what them do is, them write the events as they happen in the show. That's not a story. You are merely retelling a story, and story is not retelling. Story is you allowing the action to happen, right? As if it just happened. Even though I want to show you, but allow it to happen as if it just happened. You can't go find it. And so in developing the plot, you must there are four elements of the plot that you must include in your main plot. You have initiating incident, and this is where you introduce a conflict and you introduce a character. So in that element, we don't introduce the characters. So if a three characters you're going to include in your story, you introduce them, you introduce the setting. Then you have a rising action. So rising action is where the conflict that you introduce initially in the initiating action, that conflict will rise now. So more something else is going to happen. Yeah? So it will allow the conflict to evolve. And then you have climax. Climax is the highest point in the story. The point where people are saying, I wonder if I saw it, I'm going to go. I wonder if I and also. This is the most suspenseful part of the story, the highest point, right? And then we have fall in action. Fall in action is where the conflict or the pieces of the conflict are being tied up, but they're not fully tied up yet. They're not fully resolved. They're coming to a closure, but it's not yet closed. And then we have resolution. And so in the plot, you must have initiating action, rising action, climax, fall in action, then we have resolution. So that's the plot itself. Remember, as well, people, for the plot, do not write the plot, but develop the plot. So one thing linked to another, then something else linked to it. You can't be unrealistic. Yeah? All right. Next. Wait, come out here back. No, stop. All right. So next element. Just give me a minute. Man, where you follow me for? Where you follow me for? Where you go on your bed? Just a minute. All right, so the next element we're going to be looking at is theme, right? Of course, you know that for the theme, this is the moral of the story, the lesson that you want the readers to learn. So with your theme, however, because based on your incidents in your story, then there's going to be a life lesson. So whatever life lesson you want the reader to learn, that's the theme of your story. Once you have theme, some persons might want to say that what point of view is also an element. Of course it is, because at the end of the day, I must be able to say which point of view will I be writing the story from. Everybody knows that CSEC looks at two points of views, either first person or third person. So you don't have to worry yourself about all the points of views. You only have to learn two. First and third, for the first person point of view. And the question in CSEC will determine what point of view you take. So either you take first person or third person. So first person is where the narrator narrates the story. So he tells the story and he's a character in the story. So the story that I read before, that should be first person, because the person, little boy, is telling the story from his side and he's also a character in the story. Then we have third person. Third person is where the narrator is telling the story, but he's not a character in the story. But you don't have to worry yourself too much about that, because CSEC normally dictates the point of view. Let me show you what I mean by that. So when you go in CSEC, you will get the questions, right? The questions will determine which point of view. So for example, this June 2001 CSEC examination story writing question says, although I felt sorry for him, I don't think he deserved another chance. Right away, we know that this is first person narration, because it's utilizing the pronoun I. This first person narration normally has the pronoun, the only pronouns I, you, and we. For the third person, we know it is he, she, it, and so on. So those are the pronouns that we use to determine what sort of narration it is. First person, it's I, you, and we. So that those words are those pronouns will be used in the question. Or it could be that you say he or she or it. So in this case, this one is asking us to write the story from a first person point of view. What about, look at this other one. Era or erring for a day. So write a story based on this topic, of course. In this case, this would be third person narration, because, of course, we know I would be telling the story, but I may not necessarily be, I might not be the hero in the story. And so with point of view, you don't necessarily have to worry yourself about that one in terms of knowing that element, because CSEC dictates what point of view the story should be told from. However, we always remember though, don't just go in there and start write your story, however, because you have to remember you are being marked based on the stimulus you chose. And so if you choose the stimulus that asks you to write in a first person narration and you start the story writing third person, you're going to lose enough marks. So you have to be careful in terms of when you're choosing your question, remember that the point of view is determined by the question. So keep that in the back of your mind. Moving on to the next element, which is the title. Title says, this is the name given to your story. So most of us doesn't see title as important. Can I say, oh, show me just write my story and get a title. No. Title plays an important role as well, because guess what? If it is that you just put a title to your story, because you said the story, if you have a title and you give all your information through that, giving that title, you might find yourself in problems. Because the title is important because it gives the reader an hint as to what the story will be about, but not give the reader all of the information. So you don't want to run the risk of giving too much information in the title. And so when you're writing your story titles, you're going to write the stories first, and then you're going to write the title at the end. Don't title your story before you write it. That doesn't make no sense. So write your story, then you find an appropriate title that will not give the story away, but in fact allow the examiner wanting to read your story. Come off of the care. Come, thank you for your office. Come here. So that is for title. Remember now, for title, don't give too much information away. Give as much as, so make it interesting. Make the title interesting. Don't make it too boring. Yeah? All right. Next element could be dialogue. For dialogue, some people, we are Jamaicans, you know, so we know, say, we chat patois and so, nothing wrong with that. But remember, we're doing English language. So remember, that is the predominant language. And so that's what you're being marked for. And so nothing is wrong to include dialogue in your story. And you can also use dialect. Dialect means patois. To introduce one character, if you show one character talk, remember, you go and differentiate the character. So one character might speak English and one might speak patois. And we want to show say one dance or one not too bright and one more sophisticated. No, so we can do that. Including dialogue in your stories, though, remember, for each person who is speaking, you must include that person in a different line. So if John and Tom in a story and John talk, John can't talk in the same line where Jane talk. No. Jane talk and she's placing one line. John talk after Jane, he's placing one line as well. So every time John talk, you differentiate him in one different line. Every time Jane talk, you differentiate Jane in one different line. Remember also that you must use quotation marks in including dialogue. Everybody know that. Open and close quotation, of course. Because we know that when persons are talk, that's what we normally use. So it's good to introduce dialogue, but remember when you're doing it, because it's compulsory, you know, you don't have to do it. But if it is that you want to do it, you have to do it properly. Good? So with all this that we said, we did setting, we did plot, we did characterization, we did point of view, we did theme, we did title. All in all, though, we might still be left with the same question or the same question. How do I start my story? Because, yes, Miss, me here we ask about, I still can't start it. All right, I've got you as well. So starting your story is not all that hard. You can stick to three ways of starting your story. You can either start with a flashback. What that means, Miss? That means you start in the conflict and then you go back and tell them what happened. Right? They've watched one show yet. And the show starts when the man dead. Or then when they show the man down in the dungeon. And then it flash and show you what happened before he was thrown in that dungeon. Yes. That's what flashback means. Flashback means you start in the conflict and then you tell the reader, or show the reader rather, how we got to this point. That's how we started the story initially. The story that I read, it started with a flashback, all right? So if you don't want to use a flashback, you can also start with a description. What do I mean by description? What I mean is this. You can start with the setting. So you describe the setting wholly and solely. That means you're going to incorporate as much metaphors, similes, personification as possible so that you can bring that a story alive. That's so you can garner the interest of the reader from the get-go, right? So if you're good like that, you can start in that way. What I recommend, though, people, because we watch so many movies, we are able to relate to the flashback concept. And so it's imperative that we start with the conflict, then go back to show how you got there. That's easy. If you don't want to do that and you start off with a description, you can do that as well. Or you can start with a dialogue. Remember, no, not the conversation. If you start with a dialogue or a conversation, you don't say, hey, Tom. Tom has a headache. Because I say, what's up? I say, I'm doing fine. No. That's boring. Remember, the first impression lasts, which means then. Stop it. Which means then, people, if you're going to start with a dialogue, the dialogue must be interesting. It must be peaking to the conflict or initiating the conflict. You understand? So it could be a man held up at gunpoint and he's, you know, negotiating with his killer or his robber. That would, you know, be a good way of starting a story using a dialogue. But not because it's a dialogue that started boring. No, if you start a story boring, you might lose a reader. You ever watch, when you watch boring show, you stop watching it. Yeah. But when we watch a show and lively show, we can't even watch 1 hour, 1 or so. Yeah. So let me reiterate, or you can start the story. You can start with a flashback or with a description or with a conversation. But you have to ensure that whichever option you choose, you must ensure that it is interesting. Next. CSEC normally marks these things. Content and relevance of story, right? So they marked based on your storyline and how you develop your plot. So it says the storyline must be clearly developed. For example, the events in the story must be linked appropriately. Links must be maintained appropriate to the choice of technique. Conflicts must be satisfactorily resolved. Action must be satisfactorily concluded. Actions or events must be clearly motivated. For example, hello. There must be some plausible reason for the things that happen. So, when you're including the plot in your story, don't just because teachers say if you include plot, you just include it. So, and 2 minutes of plot is a sequence of events. We make one thing happen and then the other thing happening on a correlation, you know, but we just make it happen because it just has to happen. You're being marked based on how you develop your plot. And so, developing the plot, you must ensure that the events are linked and related and that the actions of the characters are satisfactorily concluded. It means people not act the way they, because you may just make him act the way they know. It must be a situation where it is required, right? It says setting must be established. For example, there must be a clear indication of where and when the action takes place. That's easy. That's self-explanatory. So you must include a setting in your story. The examiner must be able to identify. Yeah, man, this is the setting. We can identify where it takes place, where it's taking place, and when it is taking place. Once you do that, if setting is marked out of 5 for element, then you get the full 5. It no matter if it not do good or not write properly, once they can identify that that is the setting of the story, then yes. Characterization, though. Remember I told that you must include at least 3 characters in the story. The characters must be named and described. In describing a character, you can do indirect characterization or direct. Indirect means you describe them based on their personality. Maybe example, characters must act and use a language that is consistent with who they are. For example, that is very interesting because you can't say one character, right? Means they're sophisticated and talk patois. No. You can't say your character uptown. He's described as uptown, right? And you can't use the Queen's language, no? Yeah, you remember now, people must be able to differentiate between your characters. Who is poor and who is rich? Rich man now, I gotta have different things than a poor man. In description, it says, any change in character, for example, personality or behavior, must be clearly established. That is self-explanatory. Again, people, if your character changes in the story before your story done, the readers must know that. Because if we start off as a rich man and during the course of a story, we become poor, the readers can leave with the impression that the man is still rich. you have to ensure that the readers know that there was a transition between the character then and the character now. Good. So if you do all that in terms of develop your stories, in terms of plot, the story outline, characterization, setting, which these are the main elements, you know, then you're on your way. Did I leave anything out? I'm going to show you an example. I want to show you an example of how you can start your story using description. Because some person might say, but miss, we might not be able to start the stories in the flashback. And description, what do you mean? So I'm going to show you an example as to how you can start your story using the description method. Just give me a minute. All right, great. Ready? Nobody come to me now. We're going to play. All right, great. It says, the sun was sleeping. The full moon was shining brightly, but it was blocked by trees that towered over me. Fear gripped my heart and refused to let me go. I was running, but I was tired, and that was slowing me down. I could hear the beast's footstep as he drew closer and closer until I could smell his foul breath as I felt it in warm puff against my neck. Then at last, I felt his iron grip around my arm. So if you notice what is happening, the setting, there's a description in the story. It shows the sun was sleeping, which means it tells the time of day. The full moon was shining brightly. And so what is happening in this description is that it incorporates the setting as well as initiated the conflict. Somebody, I run this somebody down, no? So right away, the examiner reading this, the starting of the story, is compelled to read more. And they want to know, yeah? Yeah. So ensure that your story is interesting so that it can grab the reader attention, and you have to maintain interest too. You can't just grab the reader attention and maintain it. You have to ensure, say, you maintain it. Remember also, people, that in story, you must ensure that you include most of the elements so that you can get most of the marks. So these are some of the points to remember as I wrap up. So points to remember. One, keep the plot simple. That's not hard. Now, but I complicate the plot. We love complicate things too much, and that's the reason we're running problems. So keep the plot simple. Two, stick to one scene. And I'm sorry, book you right. Remember 45 minutes to get? All right, one incident. Yeah, stick to one scene for me, no? Limit time of action. So the time of action can be more than one time. If at 12 o'clock, at 12 o'clock. It can be 12 o'clock and 9 o'clock and 6 o'clock and 7 o'clock. It says focus on one event or incident. Yeah. Limit number of characters. Don't have 10. We don't have the time. Because if you have 10 characters, that means 10 of them are going to be main characters. So why do I want so much? I don't want so much. Because characterization just carry 5 marks, but I want the other marks then. It says next, you must grab reader's attention from start. So grabbing the reader's attention will be dependent on how we start. Starting the story, can start with a flashback if you're good at it. That's the easier one. You can start with a description, as I showed you the example before. Or you can start with a conversation or a dialogue. Remember though, if you're going to start with a dialogue or a conversation, it can't be boring. It have an insight. It have appear as if you're including the conflict in it. Next, you must sustain interest throughout your story. I can't grab the reader's attention and just let it. It have to maintain it. So one thing have to lead to another thing, which is realistic. And I say, yeah, man, yeah, I wonder what happened again. Yeah. You ever watch show you to keep you at your feet? Yeah. That's what your story have to do. You have to be mindful of the theme. Theme, which is the moral of the story, the life lesson. So when you're writing your story, remember, you have to know what life lesson you want the reader to learn. So you stick to that. So every event in the story is consistent to the theme. Last one, use dialogue meaningfully. So you know, just because they tell us, oh, maybe use dialogue. Some of us are use it. And I said go. Them say if you use dialogue, but you have to use it meaningfully. Meaningfully, what that means is it's a fear. Evolve the plot, mean advance the plot. So say for instance, I want to use dialogue for sure, say one man around me down, or me one man in our confrontation, instead of me writing, John and Tom was at home, a man appeared. No, me don't want to start it so. We want to use dialogue. That's how the man jumped in our yard. So we use dialogue between John and Tom. So we advance the plot. So people, when they're using the dialogue, don't just use the dialogue, because they say, you can use it. Use it meaningfully. Mr. Tony Suarez, how many minutes I have remaining? Any question, people?
You have 5 minutes remaining, miss.
How much?
5 minutes.
Wow. Wow. Is that chat long? So I'm sorry, I can't tell the time. Talk now, no?
All right, miss, give them your social media information one more time.
Oh, so people, don't forget to follow me.